Our Father, who art in heaven, we thank you so much for retired General John Kayseri. We thank you for the life that he led. We thank you for the diligence with which he served our nation, O God. Father, we thank you that he was a blessing to us, and we are honored to have lived and to have, you know, lived under his leadership, O God. Father, I just want to commit his family during this time. It is a time of mourning and a time of loss, O God. Oh, that you would be there. Oh, that you would send your helper whom you gave us, oh God, in Acts, oh God, as a comforter, oh God, that he would go in there and comfort each and every one of their hearts. And Father, as your Holy Spirit dwells amongst them, may he grant them peace and encourage them and lift their spirits up and send everybody who will support them to their aid, oh God. Father, we thank you and bless you, and we seal this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may have your seats. Good morning. It is good to see you. Now, we've been going through a sermon series called Decision 2017. And we are speaking about the state of our nation as we, as Kenyans, go to the polls and choose our next president. It's always a very interesting time. You know, normally it should be a time, you know, when we are very positive, when we have vision, when we have hope. But in our nation, it's a time filled with, you know, tension, great tension. And a few years back, you know, some giants reared their ugly heads, and we got to experience it, and it wasn't a good thing for our nation. And we'll be looking at these giants for this sermon series, and we will see how we can slay these giants. And one of the things we spoke about is that these giants, you know, in as much as they are out there, they are also in here, found in the church. And we as a church need to take our place and realize that peace slogans and crossing our fingers will not do it. But we need to stand. We need to call on the God of all creation to come and help us slay this giant. Now, last week we looked at a portion of scripture to set up this series. July is a 5-Sunday month. So last week we had a sermon that would set up this series. And we looked at John chapter 8 from verse 1 to 11. And this was the story of the adulterous woman. We learned about the Pharisees and the lawmakers found this woman, you know, in sin, and they brought her before the master while he was in, you know, in the middle of teaching, in the middle of a teaching session. And as she, you know, when they brought her there, they accused her and, you know, put her in front of everybody, you know, just to, one, shame her, but also to trap Jesus, because it was one of those catch-22 situations where there's nothing that you would say that was right. But when, as we continued reading in verse 7, he gives a very interesting response, and response that we didn't see coming, but it was the very right response. And in verse 7, he said that, let any one of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her. From this, we learned that Christ was teaching us a very valuable leadership lesson. And the leadership lesson that he was teaching us, that is, leadership begins with the state of our hearts. And that we must first look inside before we look outward. So today we'll tackle one of the giants. I feel that, you know, as I speak to many people around, we are experiencing, and for the most part, you know, everybody in a way, in one way or the other, you know, has or is feeling this with regard to this season in our nation. We're going to see from the Word of God how we are going to, you know, what he says regarding this giant, and we are going to follow that command that God has given us. One of the sentiments I really resonate, which is the giant for today, and that we'll be tackling, is apathy. You see, I see it in many of my friends and my relatives and people that I get to engage with in society. And we are almost at that place where it doesn't matter what I do. It doesn't matter whether I go to the polls or what I do. It doesn't matter. It's not going to change. So why should I care? Why should I do anything? My vote won't count anyway. In fact, most of us have gotten to that point of saying that, you know, after all, we already know who's going to win. I remember a friend sharing with me, he said that in Africa, an incumbent can never lose. This is the state of where we're at. This is the kind of apathy that we are failing. One of my first Facebook friends posted something that was very interesting, and it got numerous likes and numerous shares and comments and stuff. And it was this, and it's going to be on the screen. It was dudes whose every other social media is Jubilee NASA. Give it a break, please. How many really feel this guy? Don't raise your hands. Don't raise your hands. You guys, I know you're not apathetic, you know. But so many of us really feel what this guy said. In fact, I wanted to like it. I wanted to share it. I wanted to do all that. But I just realized with my position, what message am I passing to the people who follow me? So some of you are like, must we be here every 5 years? Especially the business people. I've been hearing people complaining. People are saying, you know, people are not spending. We are struggling. One of the guys said, hey, you know, in fact, now I'm consolidating my projects just so that, you know, we can have something to do. It's because guys are not buying, people are not investing because of the uncertainty that there is because of what is happening, you know, in this season. Some of us, you know, have relatives in certain parts of the country, and around these relatives, we have to be very careful what we say about who and how we say it, because of how charged up we are. You know, no one wants to talk about it, and for many of us, you know, the scary bit is that we feel like whether we vote or not, it will not make a difference. So what does God's word say about this fatigue that we are experiencing, about this apathy that we are feeling, this sense that we need a break? And for this, I would like for us to turn to our Bibles, to Joshua chapter 1, and we'll be reading from verse 1 to 9. For those of you who don't have your Bibles, you're welcome to get on your gadgets. At Mavuno, we are okay with that. You can take out your gadgets and follow along. But if you don't have either one, you're welcome to follow on the screens. It'll be projected as I read along. Joshua chapter 1 from verse 1 to 9. 1. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people, get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I am about to give to them, to the Israelites. I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon and from the great river, the Euphrates, all the Hittite country to the Mediterranean Sea in the west. No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you, nor will I forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their ancestors to give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this word. Father, as I speak this word, I pray that you will give it life, life that will transform us, life that will challenge us, life that will charge us, oh God, to fulfill your command that you have given us for this generation. In Jesus' name, amen. This passage begins at a time of transition. Moses, one of the great patriarchs, has died. And for those of you who may not know the story, Moses was an Israelite who lived in Egypt at the time the Israelites were in captivity. Now, Moses didn't live amongst the Israelites, but he lived in the house of Pharaoh and grew up in the house of Pharaoh. And he committed some, you know, sin, and he was kicked out of the land. So when he was out somewhere in the wilderness, you know, God calls upon him to go back to Egypt to get his people, to set his people free. Now, Moses, you know, struggles with this thing because he was like, you know, I'm not qualified. I don't have what it takes to speak to Pharaoh of all people and ask, you know, and get him to agree to get these people out. So eventually he agrees. He goes into Egypt, and after a little tussle, tug with Pharaoh, and God showing up, doing some many miracles and signs, you know, eventually Pharaoh allows, you know, Moses to take along the Israelites out of captivity and into the promised land. So at this point, Moses has taken them out of Egypt. He has gone through the, you know, through the wilderness, and now they're on the verge of going into the promised land. And that's when this transition is happening. So now God is choosing a new leader who has been set aside to go now into that land and, you know, occupy it, you know, because this was their inheritance. And the man that they chose was an aide to Moses. He was one who was very faithful. You know, he was one that had faith in God, and he served as a military commander and was a spiritual disciple of Moses. And this was Joshua, son of Nun. Now, Moses, like I said, had done his part, taken an entire nation out of captivity. And now Joshua had the task to move the nation into the land, to divide this nation and to occupy it and to claim what was rightfully theirs as promised to their forefather Abraham by God. As this transition is happening, God requires for Joshua and his generation to do something very interesting, to exert themselves in God's mission so as to inherit their destiny. Now, God's gift of the land of Israel is very fundamental to the covenant promises made to Abraham and his descendants. This was the long-awaited inheritance that was pledged to the descendants of Abraham and of Jacob. Now, in verse 5, he says, "No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you." Here God is assuring him. God is letting him know that, you know, I will direct you. I will protect you. I will watch over you as you undertake this task that I've put ahead of you. And I will ensure success for you. As we continue reading from verse 6 to 9, three times the Lord says this phrase. In verse 6, the beginning, he says, "Be strong and courageous." And then again in verse 7, he says, "Be strong and very courageous," as if to insist and emphasize, you know, what he's trying to, you know, to tell him. And then in verse 9, he goes on to say, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous." God knew that the task ahead was a daunting one. What he was to accomplish, they had never done before. They probably had never seen this happen before. So this was like new ground, new territory. And for him to be able to accomplish this, he had to be strong and to be very courageous. God is calling the Joshua generation to exert themselves in the mission or the task that is ahead in order for them to inherit their promise. When we put this in our context, we are the generation that the Bible is talking about. Most of us are a generation or two removed from those who fought for our independence, those who fought for what was rightfully our inheritance as Kenyans can be equated to the Moses of our time. They faced the colonialists. They did all the hard work. They shed blood. They had to cry many days. And it was just a battle that was just crazy for us to have the independence that we have. And now that they have gotten us the independence, now that we are in the place that we are in, we are the Joshua generation who are supposed to take this nation to the next step. The generations before us represent Moses. And we are the Joshua generation who are called to take this nation to the next level. We as a nation need to adopt a Joshua spirit and not wait for a Joshua person. I strongly believe that even though God was talking to an individual, he was actually addressing a generation. He's addressing you, a new generation that has risen and is ready to take on the inheritance of our country. The truth is, when you and I look at the state of the nation, the politics, it can be very discouraging. The government is full of scandals and corruption and laws that are, not enforced. And it feels like, it feels actually like the Wild Wild West, where only the ones with power, only the affluent are the ones who get everything. We seem to be recycling the same leaders who are part of the problem because of the ideologies they share. You and I are discouraged. You and I are disheartened. You and I are dismayed because we are not getting the full benefit of our inheritance. The standard and the cost of living is going up, yet our salaries are still the same. Income is still the same. There is no break. There is no relief. Unemployment is at an all-time high. Poverty seems to be increasing. Corruption is happening. And no one seems to be doing anything about it. And I could go on and on and on and on about it. The task for you, Mavuno Downtown, the task for us, Joshua generation, the task ahead is quite daunting. But for us to see the nation that we desire, for us to see the great nation that we are, for us it will take each one of us playing our part. Every single one of you playing your part, exerting yourself to the mission of God, like God commanded Joshua and like Joshua did. In verse 8, he says, "Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful." God is telling us, by keeping his law, in our day-to-day operations, we will be prosperous as a nation. We will see transformation in our nation. Keeping his law means that we stop the greed. Keeping his law means that we honor the Constitution. Keeping his law means we subdue the land and enjoy the fruits. Keeping his law means that we live in peace and in unity. Finally, here is what he's saying to you, as it is written in verse 9. "Have I not commanded you?" And he's stressing this. He's emphasizing this. After he's already told you before, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and very courageous." He says, "Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." Mavuno Downtown, people of Kenya, today I am here to tell you, be strong and very courageous. Do not be afraid to exert yourself and take your place. Do not be discouraged. He who is your Lord, is with you. So take your place. Play your part in the building of our nation. With him you will slay giants and that are holding us back from being the prosperous nation God intended for us to be. One of the things I ask that we guard against is I often hear us comparing our nation to nations that have gone before and done really well, the developed nations. I hear people say, oh, in America, oh, when I traveled to Europe, it was like this, it was like that. But we forget that for some of these nations, it has taken years to be where they're at. Some of them centuries to be where they're at. We are just but a young nation, only 50 years old compared to them. Some of them have done some crazier things than we could ever think or imagine. So the path that we are going on is a path that is actually an accelerated path. And we ought to give ourselves a break as a nation. The Kaizen principle states that change takes incremental gains. It takes time, little efforts here and there. It takes each one of us playing our part, exerting ourselves. This is what we need to do as Kenya. In my view, the country of Kenya, this land, this inheritance that you and I have been given, is what Christ was talking about when he was talking to the parable where he gives the talents to the three guys. Two of them doubled their talent, and one person, you know, brought to him exactly what he gave him. And he was really, really upset. Christ was so upset. Or rather, the master in that whatever was so upset. God desires for us to be productive. God desires for us to work on this, to build this. And each one of us will be held accountable for our part. So allow me to say that I actually feel that apathy towards our nation, apathy towards what is going on in our nation is a sin. God desires for each one of us to do our part. Apathy is not an option. The church must stand and take its place in the building of the nation. There is a concept in sociology known as the cumulative advantage. And it is the idea that when we achieve a small success, we store in ourselves the capacity and the confidence to achieve another success. And these successes grow incrementally. I'll repeat it. It is the idea that when we achieve a small success, we store in ourselves the capacity and the confidence to achieve another success. And these successes grow incrementally. Just think about your life. Think about where you're at. It began with small successes, a success of, you know, successfully completing standard one. Then you went to standard two. Then you went to three, four, five, all the way to standard eight. You did an exam. You completed that exam. When you completed that exam, you went to high school. You went through high school, did form one, form two, form three, form four. For some of us, went to form five and form six. We accomplished that. And after that, some of us went to university. Some of us went to vocational, school. But we accomplished all that. And we are here today. It was a process. And you had to follow the path. In like manner, for our nation, we have to follow that path. We each have to play our part. Just the other day, we had a dictatorship. A couple of, you know, people decided, no, this can't be the way we run our country. They took to the streets. Some were jailed. Some were beaten. Some died as a result of it. But eventually, in the late 90s into the early 2000s, we as a nation became a democratic nation. Today, you and I can vote for whoever we think is the right person. We couldn't do that when I was younger. We are going step by step by step by step. And it's up to us to understand there is a process. And it's up to us to follow that process and exert ourselves as Kenyans to do that. Courage begets courage. Sir Winston Churchill once said, "Courage is rightly esteemed as the first and of all human virtues because it is the quality that guarantees all others." Joshua was told, "Be strong and courageous." There was a reason God was telling him that. And Sir Winston Churchill puts it down very well by saying, "Courage is rightfully esteemed as the first of all human virtues because it is the quality that guarantees all others." We must first have courage to love. We must first have courage for us to be able to serve our nation. It takes courage to do what God has charged us to do as a nation. Instead of apathy, I'm calling on you, Joshua generation. The generation that has been called to kill and slay the giants that are keeping this nation from being the nation that we have been called to be. I strongly believe we have one of the greatest nations in the world. I have traveled the world over, and it took me leaving this country to know that the people that I come from are an amazing and great people. I've lived in the so-called developed nations, but I am yet to meet people like the ones I have come from. The ones I call my brothers and sisters. Kenyans are very intelligent. Kenyans are very smart. Kenyans are very strong people. You'll never know that until you're removed from this place. So I charge you with that which God has given you. You are a great nation. And you need to be strong and courageous and exert yourself and take your place. This is your inheritance. From Mombasa to Kisumu, from Namanga all the way to Turkana, the beauty of this nation. This is for us to take, our inheritance. Let us not let it go down in the dumps. Be strong and be of good courage. Be strong and be of good courage enough, Mavuno Downtown, by swinging into action and planning on engaging in the voting practice. By engaging in acts that make small but meaningful difference in our respective spaces of influence. Can we live without some of the excesses and put our resources together to improve a school in the neighborhood, to improve our estates? Why are you waiting for a Joshua person to make that decision for you? You have the power to rally the people around you and change the areas that you live in. It begins with us before it can translate to the leaders. Be strong and of good courage enough to fearlessly influence the political conversations. Now, I know this can be a very sensitive one. But start by robust conversations in your life groups. Start by calling out your tribesmen and your tribeswomen, letting them know that the tone and the way that they're talking, they cannot talk like that. We have to be able to engage our nation intelligently. Be strong and of good courage. by believing in your country enough to pray and to fast for it. On the 19th of July, we will begin a three-day prayer and fasting for our nation. And it's going to culminate on the 21st during worship night. And we will congregate here on the 21st for worship night from 6:30 to 9. And we're going to pray for our nation. Come ready to roll up your sleeves. Come ready to speak in tongues, for those of you who speak in tongues. Come ready to bang a wall, but come ready to do business with God for your nation. Be strong and of good courage. I want us to stand up, and I want us to say a prayer together. And the prayer that we're going to say is a very interesting prayer. I'd like to meet the person who was given this prayer, because this prayer is very relevant to our nation. And in this prayer, it says that, God of all creation, bless this, our land and nation. Justice be our shield and defender. May we dwell in unity, peace, and liberty. Plenty be found within our borders. And I love what he says after that. Now he's speaking to us, each one of you. He's saying that, let one and all arise with hearts both strong and true. Be strong and courageous. Service be our honest endeavor. And our homeland of Kenya, heritage of splendor, firm may we stand to defend. These are the words of our national anthem. This is what we say as Kenyans we are going to do when we pray and sing it. And I invite you to sing with me. I will put my hand on my heart because it means something to me. I invite you to do the same and to lift your hands to the Lord and to say the words of the prayer. Doomsayers might be prophesying something different, oh God.
But Father, we as a people, we choose today to stand and take our inheritance, O God. To fight the giants, O God, that dwell amongst us, O God. And Lord, to fulfill your command for this inheritance that you have given us. So we pray, O God, that you will give us the strength, O God. That you will give us the wisdom, that you will give us the direction, and that you will give us your Holy Spirit who will empower us to be everything that you have called us to be. That we will see a great nation of Kenya. That we will be able to enjoy the fruits of our labor. And Mavuno Downtown, as you hold hands together, hold the hand of your neighbor. And Lord, with one accord, as Kenyans, O God, we will build this nation. And be diligent, O God, to that which you have commanded us. We thank you, Lord, and we bless you. May the good Lord bless and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. May his Holy Spirit empower you to be everything he has called you for this nation. That we might see this nation prosper. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Have an amazing week, God bless you.